Good morning, everyone. When I was asked to give a presentation here, the initial intention was to talk about the history of medical imaging. Well, I've been now a decade in about working on the development of X-ray detectors, and that's just a very small field of medical X-ray imaging. So I decided to focus the talk more on the digital X-ray image quality. Nevertheless, I would like to start with some looking back in the history. This is a painting of the Dutch, famous Dutch painter Rembrandt, which is called The Anatomy Lessons of Dr. Tulp, where in the 17th century they had to open up a course to look into the body to understand what was inside the human body. They didn't have any other techniques until the invention of Röntgen of X-rays in 1895 on November 8. Röntgen was playing with vacuum tubes and had a photographic plate in his lab, and he saw fluorescence coming from this photographic plate. He decided to investigate it more, and it resulted in a publication in December 1895 about the so-called X-rays, unknown rays, also known as Röntgen rays. The funny thing here is that within a month, the first medical images were already taken with this invention. Nowadays, it's impossible to realize that that can be done. Now you need to go to all kinds of regulations and approvals before you are allowed to bring a medical system to the market. But then, within a month, the medical images were taken. And the reason is that a lot of people has had these vacuum tubes and photographic plates available. So it was very easy for them to build these type of systems. It's nice to see a little bit the evolution in the last century on X-ray imaging. To the left, there's an initial system for chest roll X-raying, and to the right, the modern system. Also in dynamic X-ray imaging, maybe even more there, a lot of improvements were made. If you look at the left picture, the doctor's head is photographic plate. They need to cover their eyes from the outside light to see the very faint glowing on the fluorescent plate. The doctor is even directly in the beam, so he got a lot of X-ray radiation. Nowadays, we take care of the medical personnel, of the clinicians, that they don't get the X-rays because we know they are harmful to the body. If you look a bit, little bit more detail in the timeline of dynamic imaging, there is an important step made, which was the image intensifier, which made the faint image much brighter, so that it evolved much more to use dynamic X-ray imaging. Then it took about 14 more years before the first digital imagers were on the market, the TFT-based flat panel detectors. And in 2010, the CMOS flat panel detectors were introduced. Okay, now I'll come a little bit to the basics, again, of image quality. Dimitra also spent a slide on this topic, but I want to go more into detail during this talk. You have to define what is X-ray image quality, and I like very much this definition, and it's also what Dimitra told in her presentation. Image quality can be defined in terms how well desired information can be extracted from the image. This image is coming from the Handbook of Medical Imaging, and those images are taken by an ideal photon counting detector, which means that every photon which is coming onto the detector is detected giving signal. And what you see here is the nature, the statistical nature of photons, photon shot noise. So if you in this image, the image looks very noisy, but that is due to the photon shot noise and not due to a poor detector or whatever. If you start to increase the noise, you start to observe more details in the images. If we now compare these two images, I don't know if it's, you can see it very well on the screen, but you still see some slight more details. Is it interesting for the clinician? I'm not the expert to answer that question. But the more those two apply, the better the image quality will be, but the worse it will be, and for the patient maybe, and for the medical personnel. So which parameters define image quality? It's the resolution, it's the signal-to-noise ratio, it's the contrast-to-noise ratio, DQE, noise, sensitivity and saturation dose, and dynamic range. And I want to go through all over these aspects in this presentation. For me, the starting point is the X-ray detector. So I'm not interested in, or I don't focus on the total system, because also the tube itself, the configuration of the system plays a role in what you will finally see in the X-ray image. But if we now have the X-ray image on the detector, what factors impact the image quality? X-ray detectors, there are mainly two important distinctions. One is the direct converted detector and the indirect conversion detector. Direct conversion means that the X-ray photons are directly converted to electron hole pairs, while indirect converters first convert the X-rays to visible photons and then to electron holes. The electron hole pairs are detected by an image sensor. It can be a CMOS panel, it can be a TFT panel. It's not very relevant for the definition of image quality. What is important here still is the scintillator. The scintillator determines also very much the image quality. For medical imaging, the material is cesium iodide doped with thallium. It's a needle-like structure, needles in the order of a few microns, which confine the light into these needles. It's not true that all the light is confined. There is still some spreading of the light possible, but it's rather confined if you compare it to other scintillators like CADOX. The thickness has an influence on the amount of X-rays that are absorbed. The thicker the scintillator layer, the better the absorption is. So if we now come to the resolution, it's the MTF, which measures the ability of a detector to resolve different spatial frequencies. And what you see here is a difference between two different detector configurations. A detector with a standard scintillator with a 100 micron pixel, a detector with a standard scintillator and a 150 micron pixel, and a detector with a high resolution scintillator. And what you clearly see here is that the high resolution scintillator improves the resolution considerably. There's not a big difference between the two pixel sizes, only the fact that the Nyquist frequency is at as another point. The curves are plotted up to the Nyquist frequency. So when designing a detector, you have to choose on the pixel size you want to use and the scintillator material that you can use. To show what the effect is of this MTF performance on a resolution image, this is a line pair phantom image for the high resolution detector and the standard detector with the same identical dose conditions. You clearly see, I don't know if you can clearly see it on this screen, but that the high resolution detector images the lines much more sharply, and five line pairs per millimeter is visible, while the standard resolution doesn't have this sharp transitions on the lines, and also five line pairs per millimeter is not visible anymore. Another aspect in imaging, in image quality, is the signal-to-noise ratio. if we take here the statistical nature into account, the photon shot noise, then the signal-to-noise ratio of the incoming image on your detector is the square root of the signal. And this means that if we change the pixel size, the signal-to-noise ratio will change as well. For a small pixel, when 100 photons come in, the signal-to-noise ratio will be 10. If we now make the pixel twice as large in both directions, so 4 times more photons will come in, the SNR will be 20. So at the identical dose, the expectation is that the larger the pixel size, the better the SNR performance. What we did is we compared the theoretical SNR to the measured detector SNR, which is shown in this graph. We determined the theoretical SNR by assuming a certain RQA spectrum, radiation quality spectrum. You know what the average amount of photons is that come for a certain dose on your detector. So you just can calculate at a certain dose and for a certain pixel size the SNR. For the same detector, if you do the measurement at the dose conditions, we find a much larger, much better SNR. In principle, this is better than the theory. Well, you would think that the detector would reduce your SNR because it will add noise, it's not very efficient, and so on. This discrepancy is much more than you would expect based on maybe the fact that your radiation quality is a broad spectrum and not one single wavelength. So we did the same for the three different detector configurations: a scintillator, standard scintillator with the 150 micron, standard scintillator with the 100 micron, and the high resolution scintillator. And what you observe here, that the detectors which have the same optical stack but a different pixel size more or less behave similar. While the detector with the high resolution has the lowest SNR performance. But actually this SNR performance is getting closest to the theoretical limit. Why do we observe this? And that's because in the scintillator, there is photospreading. So the X-ray is not directly detected in the pixel element, but there is photon spreading, which spreads the signal over several pixels. And apparently, this is the dominating factor in your signal-to-noise ratio measured on the detector. So if you make a lousy detector with a very bad MTF performance, we will achieve a very good signal-to-noise ratio. This is an image to show how you see this in an X-ray image. So if you have an even illuminated X-ray image and you equally contrast enhance them, this is the difference in noise what you observe. So this is the standard resolution detector and this is the high resolution detector. This image looks more gradually compared to this image. This is much noisier. It's actually this image much better represents the noise which is in the original signal. The interesting thing is that actually the clinicians don't like this. This is a noisy image. They prefer these kind of images. They expect that they see much better contrast in these type of images. So then I come to the contrast to noise ratio. So that defines how well you can detect an object from the surrounding. And that is related actually to the SNR, because it's always small difference in signals you want to compare, so your noise is actually you're dominated by your background noise. So if you have detectors with the similar sensitivity, the signal-to-noise ratio of a detector with a better MTF performance will be worse if you look at the value. What you, of course, always can do is to improve your signal-to-noise ratio or the contrast-to-noise ratio by applying filtering. This can be spatial and it can be temporal. If we now look at images, for the same detectors, the standard resolution detector and the high resolution detector, this is the CD Red Phantom. And it consists of cylinders of different sizes. So from in this direction, the size of the circle of the cylinder is reduced. And in this direction, the thickness of the scintillator is reduced. So there is less absorption differences between between the surrounding and the object. What you expect with the high scintillator, with the detector with the high resolution, that it would perform better in this region. It would be better to detect very small objects. While the scintillator with the better signal-to-noise ratio would perform better in this area. This is a zoom in of the top left corner. And if you compare these two, it's hard to distinguish where in this scale one detector is performing better than the other detector. It's interesting to see that if you look at this row, that the cylinders are better visible, but it's not that in this direction you clearly observe the cylinders much better. If you look in the other direction, also here it's very difficult to make a very good distinction between the two images. Maybe this one is, as expected, slightly better, but there is not a very clear differentiation. That's probably also because also your eye averages in the noise and makes the contrast visible. If we now go back again to the resolution phantom, this is an image where the dose is much lower, so you see the noise due to the photon shot noise clearly in the image, and then you do see a difference in the high resolution detector, which is better in detecting the spatial frequencies even at a low dose performance. Well, the fact that the contrast to noise ratio, the signal to noise ratio, is not the best parameter to compare detectors. Therefore, there is another very important metric which is usually used in qualifying the different detectors, and that is the DQE, detective quantum efficiency. The DQE is a measure of the efficiency with which the device uses the incoming radiation for any spatial frequency. It's the ratio of the signal-to-noise ratio squared, which comes from the detector, divided by what's going in. But what is very important here is that it is frequency-dependent. So you look at this for every frequency component in the image. There are many factors determining the DQE performance, impacting the DQE. But I will focus on a few in this presentation to get the understanding of the importance of the DQE. Anything which is in between, let's say, the image generated on top of the detector and the scintillator material will reduce your DQE. So all the materials like the carbon cap of the detector, shielding which is required for EMC, maybe the substrate of the scintillator, needs to be low absorbing materials to keep your DQE as high as possible. The scintillator absorption, and the thicker the scintillator, the more X-rays will be absorbed. So this also influences DQE directly. And another aspect is the detector noise. When does the detector noise have an impact on DQE? This is a measurement of the DQE performance of the three detectors I showed before. The blue curve, it's a detector with a standard scintillator and with a 150 micron pixel. And the red one is the same optical stack, so the same scintillator, but with a smaller pixel. And in this case, you clearly see the differences in this region of the DQE performance. So especially above 2 lines per millimeter, a detector with a smaller pixel will perform significantly better than the detector with a larger pixel. If you now look at the detector with a higher resolution scintillator, what we indeed immediately observe is that around DQE zero, the performance is worse compared to the standard detector. And at higher spatial frequencies, it's slightly improved. So this detector will perform better in detecting small objects. If we would like to use, let's say, this detector with a higher resolution at low spatial frequencies for a doctor to achieve the same image quality, it will mean that he needs to apply 50% more dose to the patient to end up with the same image quality. This is the graph for the DQE as function of dose. So if you are X-ray imaging at the photon-dominated regime, what you expect is that the DQE performance will be identical. It will not be influenced by the detector noise. But at a certain point, the detector noise will start to have an effect on the performance, and that is what you first will observe at the higher spatial frequencies. Here you see that the DQE will start to drop, and at a certain moment also the DQE at 0 lines per millimeter will start to drop. If you now make a plot in this direction, you can make it anywhere in the graph, you can clearly see where is the point that the DQE performance is impacted by the noise of your detector. And that is shown in this graph. So here for the blue curve, the DQE, the impact of the noise of the detector starts to have an effect here around 100 nanogray. So that means if the your image content which you're interested in is above 100 nanogray in your image, then the detector noise will not have an impact. But if you go to lower dose levels, and for example in fluoroscopy, the dose ranges of the interesting information is from 5 to 100 nanogray, here the detector noise will have an effect, and the image is no longer photoshot noise limited. If we take a detector with a lower saturation dose of 5 microgray, it will also have a better noise performance, and here indeed you observe that the noise performance, the influence of the detector noise, starts to have an effect of about 10 nanogray. So this is an important aspect to keep in mind when designing your detector for a certain imaging task. Then another important parameter, of course, is the dynamic range saturation dose sensitivity of a detector. You cannot have an endlessly dynamic range. So it's always related to the saturation dose you want to have and a certain noise of your detector. Here there are two detectors with two different dynamic ranges and sensitivity. So one has a saturation dose of 5 microgray, the smaller one, with a 71 dB performance and 4.5 dN of noise. And lower sensitivity performance with the saturation dose of 24 microgray, larger dynamic range, and in the end, a lower noise. Generally, in principle, if you have a low sensitivity detector, so this one with a high dynamic range, it is possible to apply gain if you're especially interested in this area and to get a high sensitivity mode. However, by applying gain, you also will gain the noise. So that would mean, in this case, if you would go from this low sensitivity mode to this high sensitivity mode, you need to apply a gain of about 5 times. That means also that the noise would have been applied 5 times, and you end up with more than 10 dB of noise. The advantages of CMOS sensors is that you can design 2 sensitivity modes or 3 sensitivity modes in 1 pixel. And that then you have the choice of having a sensitivity mode with a low noise, those low noise performance for the images where you need the high sensitivity, and you have a mode for the large dynamic range where you have a lot of saturation, need a lot of saturation dose in your image, but also the image will have a slightly higher noise level. So this is a kind of summary of the trade-offs I've shown so far. On one hand, you have resolution versus the contrast to noise ratio. What you can do, if you have a high resolution detector with a lot of detailed information in it, you can apply filtering to improve the signal to noise ratio or the contrast to noise ratio. Better of SNR and CNR is to use the DQE, DQE zero, or DQE is function of spatial frequency, and the resolution. If you compare this, it's very important that you know what your imaging task is. If you're mainly interested in small objects with a high difference in absorption, then it's better to use the detector with high resolution. If you're interested in large objects with which where you are interested in small differences in absorption, it's better to focus on the DQE performance at low spatial frequencies. Another element is the detector noise. So your detector noise should not add noise to your image, meaning that if you know in which dose range you're working, the detector DQE should be still at the Photoshop noise limited regime in that dose range. But this is a nice bridge again actually to the talk of Dimitra. Again, if I come back to what was the original definition of image quality, is how well the desired information can be extracted from the image. It means that to design a perfect detector, or even a perfect detector, you need to know what the desired information is. But here it's also a little bit the chicken and egg problem. If you don't have the detector, you don't know what the desired information is. So if I would ask the clinicians now what needs to be improved, it will be small improvements to make it slightly better. But as long as you don't have the technology to show things, you don't also know what you're looking for. And that's what you actually have seen. Dimitra gave some nice examples in this as well. That during the development phase of several technologies, you indeed see that you better understand what the desired information is for a certain technology. These are not the only parameters when developing a detector. Also, aspects to consider, and very important aspects which also have an influence on your detector design, are the lag and coasting performance. Lag is the image information which is there from previous image appearing as a residual image in next images or in next frames if you do dynamic imaging. So this needs to be as low as possible. There should not be any information of a previous image in the next image. Ghosting means that there will be sensitivity variations due to previous exposures, especially in the high exposure ranges. It can be that part of the detector has a different sensitivity than the part of the detector which didn't have this high exposure. Also, this aspect should be as low as possible. It should be so low that it will not impact your image quality. For the users of the system, the stability of your detector is very important. What you want is that you can use one Kane and offset calibration over the full temperature range. And what you also want is that you can directly start working with the detector. That you don't have to wait for half an hour before the detector is stabilized. When you want to use your system, you want to immediately be able to put the detector on. Power consumption, important for system manufacturers. The frame rate is an interesting one. That is also a trade-off between your pixel size and your frame rate. Smaller pixel sizes means larger images for a certain area, and that generally reduces frame rate. So also here you need to know your application well to make your design choices. And the interfacing and bandwidth. The choice of the interface can mean that you limit your frame rate of your bandwidth with which you can transfer all your images to the system. This is the slide where I would like to end my presentation. So the design requirements for a detector is a balancing between several trade-offs. There are trade-offs in X-ray image quality, but there are also trade-offs in the use of a detector. You need to work together with the system manufacturers, the clinicians in the field, to understand what is the best trade-off for certain applications or certain imaging tasks you want to achieve. Well, thank you for your attention.